All right. Greetings from the Paradise Realm, where we bask in God's light and love for eternity.
Only you do. I'm here in the darkness. Hold on.
Yes, in the darkness. I've got... Oh, blimey. I mean, I've got all the lights off and all the blinds down in my office. I don't know what more I can do.
It's okay, Yats. It's going to have to do. For those of you listening to the audio version of this, we were just playing around with our lights. Ha-ha. Watch the video version. So, review scores, are they still necessary? They will not go away.
Well, certainly not these days, because now there's all this Metacritic going on that requires it.
Mm-hmm. Metacritic or Rotten Tomatoes or whoever and whatever, and you know what? It's all a bunch of malarkey.
There's always been review scores, though. Even when I was reading, like, video game magazines for the Commodore 64 and the ZX Spectrum when I was a kid. They were usually given scores out of 100% for each game.
Sure.
And they'd do a little short summary list of ups and downs and then give the score out of 100 to the side.
I guess it's very intuitive to like grade the game that you played, right?
Yeah, but as you say, these are subjective opinions.
Right.
And perhaps it made more sense back in Commodore 64 days because there was very little nuance to the games. They were very simple games.
Well, you know, they still do this. They do this with everything. They do this with books. They do this with movies. They love putting little numbers on criticisms. Actually, I did some research this morning. I was trying to find the first instance of someone using a score, you know, like a number score in a review of literally anything. And I was unable to find it.
Well, I'll tell you why, because this has been a thing from the beginning of time. Because we didn't always just arbitrarily come up with numbers. There's always like some kind of objective measure.
Mm-hmm.
Like the best Athenian general in classical antiquity was the one who'd won the most battles. That's a number. That's a subjective number.
An objective so
things are
always, number.
Things right. are objective, rather.
Right.
Thank you. So things have always been like judged by like some kind of measure.
I mean,
admittedly, that's a pretty hard thing to break down.
Mm-hmm.
Number of battles won, you either won or you lost. It's not the same as did this created piece of art emotionally move me out of 10. But well, still, video games are given awards. The Last of Us 2 received a large number of the game awards. So if you judge the game's quality by the number of awards it's gotten, The Last of Us 2 must be pretty fucking good.
Must be.
No, that's a number. Number of awards. No, and all reviews can be, as Rotten Tomatoes does, sorted into either positive or negative reviews.
Mm-hmm.
And then you just list, and then you just count up how many positive reviews versus how many negative.
Right, and I guess like that to me is the big issue with review scores is you are trying to... like I said in the show, like you're trying to translate two languages that cannot be compatible because one is from multiple sources and is subjective and one is objective. There is no objective game reviews unless you are purely talking hardware specs.
Well, you say there's no objective game reviews, but people in the comments often demand an objective game review.
Yeah, and they're wrong.
Oh, don't you realize that Super Smash Brothers is objectively a good game? Do I have to come over and explain it to you? Wow, what a bad reviewer you are. That's you, gaming public. That's all of you.
Right? Like, the only objectivity in game reviews is, like, does it run on the hardware I'm trying to run it to? And when I push the controller in the direction, does it do the thing I... tell it to do. Like, that's it. That's the only objectivity in game reviews.
Right.
And even that's subjective because perhaps the game, much like your Octodad, is messing with things like your ability to control your character, and that's the artistic vision. There is just no gosh dang objectivity.
And yet people demand scores on the reviews.
Ugh.
The reason why there are scores on reviews is because it's demanded.
I guess. And you know,
people want to be informed and they want to be told yes or no. They want to know, is this game good? Will I like it?
Mm-hmm.
They come to the gaming press and we say, yes, you will like it. So they buy it. That's the relationship. That's our purpose. And that, you know, as I say, you can break down anything to numbers. And if you can either recommend a game or you could not recommend it. That's all people want to hear.
Right, but like even that to me is less number based, because like if you put a number on that, that number lives outside of like your personal recommendation, right? Like a game, this game is a 7. It's the 7. It doesn't matter what I say about it positively, what I say about it negatively. It's a 7. My idea of a 7 and someone else's idea of a 7 is could be drastically different. But if you say, I recommend this, there's no number attached to that. You can list all the pros, well, all the cons.
There is. The number is 1. It is a 1 rather than a 0. That's what I'm saying. It's a binary scale. Recommend or don't recommend.
Right, but there is no removal of that binary scale from the larger context of your review.
Possibly. I sometimes take a point in pride that people put comments on my zero punctuation reviews saying they can't tell if I recommended it or not.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good sign for me.
And why is that?
Tell if, so it somehow falls between the binary scale. Mm-hmm. It was neither a 1 nor a 0. I am an enigma. I am outside of your system, man.
Oh, no. There's so much edge here. I can't take it.
But as you say, you know, I work in the kind of review that's a more sort of critical essay area.
Yes, you are a personality, not just a critic, which is the other side of this is we have seen a surge, if you will, of, you know, the video essay, the long form review, the detailed breakdown, the personality side of criticism is really thriving in our digital era.
But then we get into the difference between criticism and review. A work of criticism is in itself a work of art that people like experience to pass the time, to get some enjoyment out of viewing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you got to hope you'll get some kind of enjoyment out of watching a 2-hour video essay.
I would really hope so.
Whereas a review is something that exists for purely informative purposes, to just give you a bare information on whether or not something is worth getting. You can review a lawnmower. You can't critique it.
Why not?
Well, I suppose you could critique if it's like painted in weird colors.
Or you could critique its performances. You could talk about your personal experiences using the lawnmower. I have a hard time understanding the difference between a review and a critique.
Okay. You can review. You can review someone's mathematical formula.
Okay.
And check that it's accurate.
Mm-hmm.
You can't critique it because it's either correct or it isn't.
Oh.
So something that's designed for pure function, like a garlic press. I don't know why I just thought of a garlic press.
No, and I think that's fine.
It's probably because I made a garlic sauce the other night.
And I bet
you
it
can
was
review
very
whether garlic press crushes garlic or not. That's a review. Yes, it crushes garlic.
Uh-huh.
No, it doesn't. You can't critique that garlic press.
Oh,
because a critique would be a long-form exploration of how it crushes garlic. And you can't because it either crushes garlic or it doesn't.
I'm gonna be a pedantic asshole here and just say that I feel like these two worlds are more intertwined than you think. Because then your critique then would be about your experience using the garlic press. How do the handles feel? Does it store safely away? How easy is it to wash, Yahtzee? There is, to me, it's all wibbly wobbly. I enjoyed your math analogy where it's like, one is correct or not, but I don't know if that necessarily translates over to the arts. As far as review versus critique, and yes, this is me being an absolute pedantic asshole.
I'm just trying to think of a purely functional thing.
I tend
to think of a review as, you know, exploring the pure function of something.
Okay, well then...
As I said, review a math formula, either it works or it doesn't. Either you've got all the numbers in the right place or you don't.
Okay,
that can be reviewed by like a teacher or a peer.
So then reviews cannot exist when we're talking about artistic endeavors.
I guess not. You have to critique those things. But video games are in a unique position because they have both an artistic and a purely functional element to them.
Okay, all right, I'm with you.
And there is frequently a blur between those two elements, as you brought up the example of Octodad, which is deliberately hard to control. That would normally be an objective failing if a game was hard to control or unintuitive, or it just plain didn't work. But if it's intended to not work, then it becomes a grey area, which is where critique comes in. Where you critique not so much the function of the subject matter as the motives behind it, how effectively it brings across its message.
Sure.
But the review reading public will never appreciate that nuance.
Well, I like that, though. I like that we're discovering kind of the nuance within our own professions, and I dig that. I dig on that. And I guess, like, to me, you know, the you know, even though like what we just said is criticism, games criticism exists in this weird wibbly world between review and criticism. I mean, I suppose any criticism, whether it be movies, games, books, art criticism, exists in this world where it's about technique and personal experience. The point still applies that we are seeing a rise in your personality-based criticism, reviews, whatever you want to call them. We are seeing the opposite side of this coin thrive in the digital era.
Yes, not so much review scores on your video essays.
No. No, which is, to me, it's speaking to a need, a want that those of us who are interested in things like video games and movies really wanted. We want more in-depth analysis. We want longer form products. We don't just want a 7, but I guess some people just want a 7.
Well, in the olden days, that's what a magazine was for. It was like a consumer report. It was an industry paper to explain what's going on in the industry.
Sure.
At that time.
Mm-hmm. That's what my research did find, because I was looking up the history of video game criticism, and the first reviews were from like arcade trade publications to make sure, and they were meant for like arcade owners to be like, will buying this arcade machine bring more customers into my arcade? Those were like the first reviews of video games.
Those would be reviews. By my pedantic definition of such.
Exactly, because there'd be no like, oh yeah, this is fun. It would be like, yes, this will draw children to your arcade so they can empty their pockets.
Yes. it was an insider thing.
Yes. Ooh, and so now what we're talking about is kind of the difference between insider jargon and everyman criticism.
I guess there's been a lot of blurring of the lines because that sort of insider review came down to a recommendation whether or not to invest in the product for the betterment of your business and ongoing life.
Right.
And as video games become more artistic, that they kind of clung to that idea of it being a recommendation. But I guess film reviews are recommendations at the end of the day. Who can say?
But I mean, they're just as notorious for putting numbers on them. Obviously, Rotten Tomatoes is the biggest site. They are notorious. Metacritic as well for movies. Oh, pardon me. And it's just as bad. It's just as bad. Like, you know, you brought up during the show, game companies putting like review score bonuses attached to people's salaries, which is absurd. And in movies, they do the same thing. Like if a movie is certified fresh on Rotten Tomatoes, that will be on every advertising poster. This is certified fresh, 87%, 95% of people like this movie. You will statistically be inclined to like this movie. Please come and see the movie.
Corporations would like it if we were all, if it would all fit nicely into percentages, wouldn't we?
Yes. Numbers. Be a number, please.
Yes, please be a number so we can more accurately predict what you're going to like and just give you targeted ads all the time. Oh, wait, yes. That's what they do anyway.
Hey, that it's honestly, it's what social media is all about.
Maybe people watch more video essays these days because we've just got more time on our hands. Maybe we have taken more to taking in the art and entertainment we consume as part of our identities.
Mm-hmm.
And we watch like lengthy critical essays to sort of reaffirm our identities.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's all an attempt to distract us from the horrors of the real world that we've all fallen hook, line, and sinker for.
A little bit of A, B, and C.
If I were to objectively review the corporations at how good they've distracted us from real issues, I give it a solid 87%. Well done, corporations.
Right? Like YouTube, Google, you're killing it. You've really distracted me. Facebook and Twitter, you're going down in scores recently because you're starting to show me the horrors of the world instead of distract me from them. So work on that. I think it's a little A, B, and C. I think you're right. I also think that it's because of the ability to communicate across vast distances, we are also finding our niches easier. Like for me being a mostly a film nerd, I had a small group of friends who I would at length discuss movies with, but anyone outside of them, I would go in depth on a movie and they would look at me like I was an idiot, mostly because I am an idiot. But now that we have the internet, I can find someone who lives in Missouri who is also a film nerd and watch their YouTube channel. And we can have that relationship.
It's interesting how watching these long form reviews might be a part of becoming part of an in-group. Like the appeal of being part of an in-group, that we understand all these points they're making.
Yeah.
What if the entire world was the in-group?
Oh, then the entire world would have to agree on literally anything.
Maybe not then.
you would even just need the entire world to like, or not even the entire world. You would need like, what, 60% of the world to agree on something. And even that's not going to happen on any one thing. You can't let them agree. They cannot agree on any one thing.
Well, speaking of that kind of thing, I'm reminded of the negative results of review scores in the form of fans getting very, very angry because you didn't give 9 out of 10 to the new Zelda. You gave it 8 out of 10, and that's just unconscionable. People have gotten death threats for that kind of thing.
Right, which that's horrible. These people are horrible who would do that. Yeah, that's, you know, like one of the biggest jokes as far as game criticism is concerned is, you know, your game really sucks if it only gets a 7 out of 10.
Because apparently it seems like going under 7 feels like too controversial a move for a lot of people. Because of the nuance. Maybe there's some people who like The Last of Us Part 2. I've never met any.
I'm sure there are. I mean, there has to be. There has to be people who love that game.
Apparently, they all work for the Game Awards. Hey,
heyo. No, I think like 7 used to be the bottom of the barrel, but now that everyone knows that 7 is the bottom of the barrel, 8. Like, if you get a low 8 score, that's the new 7, and so people do. They get upset when a game they really like is an 8. Who does it? Someone made a fantastic video. I want to say his YouTube name is Stir, STER.
Mm-hmm.
Give me a moment while I Google it. It's a fantastic video, kind of looking at the history of the 7 video game, all centered around like the PlayStation 1 Jackie Chan game.
I don't know that one. Was it a fighting game?
It was like a brawler or like a side-scrolling brawler.
Okay.
There's
been multiple Jackie Chan games.
I'm sure there has been.
A friend of mine once showed me a digitized one-on-one fighting game in the vein of Mortal Kombat.
Oh.
That was Jackie Chan themed, and three of the bosses were just Jackie Chan in different roles.
I believe it. Oh, no, and actually, you know what? I'm wrong. It's 8. So the name of the video is basically Jackie Chan is an 8. And it's by a YouTuber named Star, STAR underscore. And okay. It's a fantastic look at the way that games are scored. And it's an older video. It's a few years old at this point, so I don't know how relevant it is. But it's something I think about often as far as like why people hate when a game that they think is perfect or very good at least gets a 7 or an 8, because we've been conditioned to think that 7 is the lowest because most review score sites won't go lower than 7 because they don't want to piss off their advertisers. Which is the dirty little secret here, right?
Because once you take to something like Metacritic, where they aggregate all the reviews, the scores start drifting into different areas. But it's the problem with Metacritic, of course, is that everyone has different standards for how they score things.
Exactly.
As you say, a 7 might be a 0 for certain game
outlets. Oh, yeah. Well, and that to me speaks of a larger problem, which is, you know, like you hate to say, like, I'm not going to use the phrase ethics, but
ethics in game journalism.
I will absolutely not refer to that, as most of that malarkey was absolute malarkey.
Yeah, well, we need to find a different phrase, I suppose.
Yes.
Like,
but
morals in consumer reporting.
Sure, morals in consumer reporting. The fact is that most of the advertising for a game review magazine or website or whatever comes from game publishers. And game publishers might be less interested to give these people money if they keep making fun of all of their games.
But how can you have an unbiased critical media in such an environment? You can't.
You can't. And
that's the problem.
There's this elephant in the room, which is why, you know, a 7 being bad is such a big joke.
Games criticism should be funded by the public, like the BBC.
Ooh.
Just everyone should be taxed a small amount of extra money, and they could all come to me. And I can be a completely unbiased reviewer, and we don't have to let advertisers get involved.
That would be nice. That would be really nice.
That's how a lot of them work on YouTube, though, isn't it? Well, most of them are Patreon supported.
Oh, I mean, they all have to be, right?
And when you advertise on YouTube, the entity putting the adverts on your videos are generally disconnected from the entity creating the video. So,
correct.
So the corporate studios get less shitty about it.
Oh, right. And of course, like there's an equal amount of malarkey over in the YouTube review sphere where, like, not only do they have a Patreon, not only are they running ads on their videos, but a lot of these gaming channels are sponsored, you know, or do sponsored videos for, you know, Call of Duty Battle Pass or whatever bullshit they got. So there's equal moral
Skillshare. Most of it seems to be Skillshare these days.
It used to be Audible. Now it's Skillshare. Or
Skillshare, it's
Squarespace.
What's the other one?
Yeah, Squarespace, the website builder.
Or what's that one? That one video game, Raid Shadow Legends.
Yes,
Raid Shadow. Everyone that sponsors absolutely bloody everything, and no one knows. No one's ever played it.
Right. And so, like, there's some morally gray area over there too. But if a reviewer does no sponsored content and only gets money through their ad revenue and Patreon, you can assume at least honesty. But even then, we're talking about honesty from their perspective, right? which is why everything's subjective.
Well, it just seems like YouTube is the new games journalism.
Sure.
I mean, everyone knows that the old games journalism can't be trusted. The old official sites, your IGNs, your whatevers.
Your whatevers.
Paid by the publishers and give review scores on arbitrary scales.
They all voted for The Last of Us Part II to win Game of the Year. Therefore, they cannot be trusted.
Fuck those guys.
Honestly. But as you say,
it's more common these days for people to get information from YouTubers. And
absolutely.
So this is a different age, perhaps.
It is. It is a different age, and I think it's better off than it was because so many of these reviewers or critics or whatever, or commentators, whatever we want to call them, are self-funded, right? But, all right, I'm going to add another layer onto this. Obviously, like, this is a meaty subject for you and I, as this is most of our lives.
But, add another layer to this meaty lasagna.
Marinara. The other layer to that is audience expectations. So you no longer have to worry about the video game publishers swaying your opinion, but you now have to worry about your audience swaying your opinion because they pay the bills now.
Right. I mean, even leaving aside the ones that will kill you for giving Zelda an 8.
Right.
There's a risk in like going against the grain, I suppose. Even if it's just your comments getting taken over by a load of shit talking people. That can be a problem.
That can be a problem. Like what, you know,
it's hard to engage the audience when they're trying to engage through a wall of people talking shit.
What if, for example, historically you have not been kind to like the Super Smash Brothers series?
Yes.
Or even The Last of Us. We've mentioned The Last of Us many, many times, right? So let's say The Last of Us Part 3 comes out. Most of the critics hate it. You find that you love it. That goes against your brand, right? This is obviously a very hypothetical situation. That goes against your brand. Will your core audience turn on you because of that? And do you even subconsciously think about that before a review?
I think it's true that I do think about audience response.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking about writing my Cyberpunk review, thinking about what the general opinion is.
Sure.
And if going too far out of the way will alienate the audience.
Because
at the end of the day, a reviewer's job is to, a critic's job is to say things that people agree with. You want to attract an audience that agrees with your views so they will consult you on their future purchasing decisions.
Sure, sure.
But in that specific case, I don't think it would necessarily be off-brand for me to suddenly start liking The Last of Us if they did a good one, which is, incidentally, is a very big if.
Well,
but if
I was trying to think of an example that would be very off-brand for you.
I reckon I could swing that to make it on-brand.
Okay.
What I'd have to do is review it in such a way where I say I like it, but in a way that makes me sound like I hate myself for saying it.
Ooh, you've got an ace up your sleeve.
Do you know what, viewers? It's not that bad. It's not that. For the benefit of the people listening on SoundCloud, I just mimed putting a gun in my mouth while saying those words.
I really enjoyed the story, in fact.
The issues of multimedia.
Well, I guess what I'm saying here is while, and I truly believe that we're having a fascinating golden era of criticism and, you know, long form essays. While all that is true, how's your battery level? Is that what you're
looking at?
Yeah, it's good.
Okay. The moment I thought it had turned off, but I was wrong.
Okay. Oh, great.
It was just the glare.
So anyway, while we are in a kind of a golden era of criticism and long form critique and review and analysis, I'm really enjoying all of it. A lot of these problems are the same problems just morphed for the new medium.
It's possible. And I take issue with the notion that we're in a golden age of reviewing.
It's because of golden age.
There's a lot of it.
Yeah.
But that's not necessarily make it good.
A lot of it's pretty good, though.
You know what was funny? Was like back in the 90s when there was just magazines and not the internet. Some games, some movies wouldn't be able to find a positive quote or a positive award graphic to put on their box art. And they'd have to like really scrape around looking for something. And if you go and look up the old box art for something like Deus Ex, what was the second one called? Invisible War.
Okay.
I found an old box art for Deus Ex Invisible War, and they had a little graphic on it which said, PC format, silver award. That was literally the best review they could find for it. A silver award. And some other magazine gave it Game of the Month. Game of the Month. Basically, it just has this string of incredibly mediocre awards.
Okay.
But then you look at these days, someone has done a positive review of everything. You can find a positive quote for absolutely anything. It's meaningless now. That's why it was so hilarious to see a game with a silver award on the front. That was how they were selling it.
Yeah.
They couldn't just like find Johnny Makework on YouTube to say, oh, this is the best game ever. Or something that sounds official, like the Gamers Collective Network, which is like two guys in a basement.
Right.
And get them to say, this is the best game ever. So you can stick the quote on the blurb and add Gamers Collective Network and make it look good.
Mm-hmm. Can...
So these days, you could argue that criticism has sort of lost a lot of its meaning because there's so much of it and that it's basically a positive opinion for everything.
There's a lot of garbage. How about this? Instead of living in a golden age, what if we live in a gilded garbage age?
An age of gilded garbage?
An age of gilded garbage.
Well, if anything sums up this year, perhaps that would be it.
There's so much garbage, but there's this gold lining over it, where little flecks of gold...
For some reason, I'm specifically thinking of how the current U.S. president has a gold toilet in his house.
Theming, my friend. We're going for a hard theming.
Apparently.
I guess all I'm saying is, I mean, I agree with you that we have a ton of garbage.
There was a time when a critic was a sort of expert position.
Mm-hmm.
You had to show your credentials to get into it.
Right. Oh, yeah. Who cares about that now? How many followers do you have? That's the only credential you need anymore.
But now anyone can do it, even if they don't know anything about the subject matter.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all part of our continued turning our back on the subject of experts.
Mm.
That means it's going to be really needlessly difficult to get people to vaccinate themselves against a deadly illness.
I mean, yes and no. I agree with you. I feel like...
What I'm saying is that people who don't listen to me are exactly the same as vaccine deniers.
When you're right, you're right. I think when you're right, you're right. And here you're right mostly because you're mostly right. I do think there's a difference in not believing scientists and choosing to, you know, watch someone whose approach to art is similar to yours. But hey, that's just me. I'm on the fringes.
Experts, that's the point.
You don't necessarily...
You need experts, surely.
You need experts in life. You don't necessarily need experts when you are looking for video game criticism.
No, fair enough. But an expert might look at a game that you thought was really innovative and tell you that, no, actually, it's ripping off like these three other games from like 20 years ago that no one else has heard of.
Yeah, but that expert might also be really boring. And
what
that's
do you mean?
Waste
that sounds
time.
Like a really interesting thing to know. I bet anyone who knows that sort of thing would be really interesting to listen to.
And I bet there's also eight other people who know the exact same stuff, but also do wacky voices. And I'd rather watch them.
Just gravitates to wacky voices in the end, doesn't it?
It's vaudeville forever.
Get a wacky voice that's wackier than your neighbor, and the world of YouTube will beat a path to your door.
All you need is a wacky voice, some solid analytical points, and
intellect. Second one's optional.
Not the whole thing. You just need one or two solid analytical points, and you need to criticize a large intellectual property. That's how you become YouTube famous. You're welcome.
Is that one of those, like, you can have two out of the three, but not all three situations? Like how when you meet potential romantic partners on the internet, they can either be sane, attractive, and not single. They can either be sane, single, and not attractive, or they could be single and attractive but not sane. You can have two, but never all three.
No. This is the basis. A lot of times, as someone who has been mildly successful on the internet, oftentimes I get asked how to become successful on the internet. And no, those are the three things. You need something to talk about. You need to do it in a funny voice, and something you talk about needs to be a large intellectual property. Pulling an example out of my head here, I enjoy the cooking YouTube channel Binging with Babish. I don't know if you
do too.
That's a fantastic show. He's a very good chef.
I like him because he's got a beard. You like him because he's bald.
There you go. Yes, Babish is bald, and I like him for it. And I don't know how you found him, but I found him because he was cooking a recipe based off of a movie or TV show.
Yeah, I think I watched him because he was making one of them comedy burgers from SpongeBob SquarePants that's like nine times too big to be a burger.
So he was basing it off of an intellectual property you already knew. He has a good and funny voice, and he knows at least a little bit of what he's talking about. Those are the three things you need.
Well, there was also the hook that he was making something comically absurd.
Sure. But
that was a good hook.
Without the SpongeBob element of it, would you have watched it? Because it's the
initially,
IP that gives you the...
Probably not. It was, as I say, it was the hook. Yeah. It was like, oh, I'm curious to see if he successfully made a sandwich 24 layers high.
Oh, well, if you just came across that and he's like, I'm making a burger that's 24 layers high without any SpongeBob element, you probably would not have clicked on it because it was the SpongeBob element that gave you the context.
Possibly.
Another cooking show or that I used to watch, I don't know if they make it anymore actually, is when the people were making the gourmet versions of like garbage candy. I don't know if you've ever seen that one.
Is it like 12 cooking YouTube there's like channels there's that have done something like that?
There's a million of them. But I guess basically, big IP gives you context. Entertainment means you'll enjoy watching it, and as long as you know a little, as long as the presenter knows at least a very small amount, you can feel like you're being informed as well.
It also helps to have a voice that people like to hear. Some people really shouldn't be doing voiceovers.
Yes.
There are a lot of commenters on the internet, on YouTube, that I stop listening to because their voice sounds like Kermit the Frog.
Yeah, unfortunately.
People tell me they find my voice rich and encouraging. I'd like to fall asleep listening to my dulcet tones and non-standard accent.
The non-standard accent helps your, are we going to call it a baritone?
I'm going to say that's deeper.
You think?
I don't know.
Like bass is the deepest. Baritone is one up from that. I don't think you're a tenor. A tenor would, you know, that's mid-rangey.
Okay. Well, probably baritone.
That's what bass.
Is it gyro day?
Oh, there you go. Now you go full NPR.
Is that better? You're listening to the Smooth Jazz Hour. 24 minutes of uninterrupted smooth jazz coming your way. After this advertisement from Viagra.
You've done the smooth jazz like a tenor. That's more NPR, where they're like, this hour on the news, we will be talking to Senator John Kerry. I don't think he's a senator anymore. In any case, how did we get there?
I don't know. We were talking about what you need to succeed as a YouTube reviewer. Well, don't put scores on. We've established that.
They're don't put scores on.
And we're done talking about that because enough has been said.
Honestly.
Points are dumb. Nuanced reviews. Just watch YouTube video essays because we know you've got lots of free time since you're all stuck at home.
Mm-hmm.
You lazy assholes.
And also, like, for creators out there, while I do enjoy video essays, oftentimes I would also prefer a podcast version, which, you know, I know you here on this show, we do a podcast version and a video version because some people like to watch, some people like to listen. I would appreciate a podcast version. And if you have any graphics, you can, like, you know, say what the graphics are.
Just watch YouTube videos on a window in the background.
They're
the same as listening to a podcast, isn't it?
No, because sometimes, like, I'll be, like, doing yard work, and I like to listen to podcasts when I do that, and then I can't, like, look at my phone when they're like, if you see this graphic here, you know, right. Like, oh, what are you talking about? That's just a suggestion from me, a listener of things. That's literally, I'm just putting that out in the world now.
Okay, so to summarize, have a weird voice.
Yeah.
Talk about something high profile.
Yep.
Know what you're talking about.
At least a little bit. One or two points, you can fake the rest.
So where would we put being funny?
That would go in.
Do you think that's an important ingredient? I would say it certainly doesn't hurt.
That goes in the funny voice category. Like, okay, being entertaining. I guess we can exchange funny voice for being entertaining, right? Okay. Whether that's funny voice, funny visuals, interesting edits, that sort of thing. Entertaining, okay. Small amount of knowledge, big intellectual property.
And if you're serious about making a go at it as a career, consistency.
Ooh.
Put out a video every week for 10 years,
mm-hmm.
and you'll probably do better than people who made like three viral hour videos that came out 6 months apart.
Probably, you know, if not once a week, because I know once a week is tough, at least twice a month.
Yeah.
People
appreciate consistency. I mean, soap operas still drawing a big audience, even though they're horribly written and really cheaply made, because they're consistent.
Absolutely.
They become part of the background noise of people's lives. People start to depend on it. They want to know what's going to happen at Jason and Kaylee's wedding because they've been hearing about it for the last 2 weeks and it's been built up too much in their heads.
Well, no, and I know, like, before The Escapist was on YouTube, like, I knew every Wednesday was the new zero punctuation, and that for me it came out around noon. And so it's like, oh, okay, I go here at noon or after noon on Wednesday to watch the new ZP. That was part of my schedule.
That's what you do. You become part of someone's schedule.
Absolutely.
And if you miss a week, people might forget about you.
No, they will forget about you.
Like living under the sword of Damocles, being a YouTube reviewer. There's so much other shit people could be watching.
Yeah.
You gotta have, if you got nothing else, you gotta have consistency.
Hmm. Absolutely. Well, and I think like you were talking about with your online dating app. These are the, you know, big IP, something interesting to say, something entertaining, and they're all scalable. So, like, let's say you're not the most entertaining person, but you have something interesting to say or something very technical to say, that's okay. Or if you're entertaining and have something technical to say, but you're saying it about a very small game or movie, that's okay. It's all scalable.
Yeah.
But so go ahead.
If you're entertaining and talking about something small scale, you can get away with not knowing much. You can be PewDiePie, in other words.
Hey! Well, that's the thing. But I suppose it's scalable in that if you slide one of those sliders in any direction, it needs to be compensated with one of the other sliders.
Right.
So just something to keep in mind, where I know, like, everybody who talks about video games wants to bring attention to smaller games. but the numbers don't lie. When we talk about smaller games, we get smaller numbers. And so it's yeah. a balancing act.
I mean, that's probably one of the main factors in what's going to like break 500,000 views when it comes to zero punctuation on YouTube mm-hmm. is the existing profile of the game, as I've explained to to my editor on a couple of occasions.
That's how it works sometimes, and there's no control we have over that. But if you have something very interesting to say about that game, and or you are very entertaining about it, it can balance out.
All right.
All right.
Figured out the formula. Turns out everything can be broken down to an objective number crunch, and you proved my point.
Son of a bitch, you're right. I was walking into a trap this whole time.
So, yeah. So make sure you've distributed your experience points evenly across your different skill bars in your internet review profile.
Or go full min-max.
Yeah, be like insanely interesting to watch. Like you're from Mars and...
son of a bitch.
You've got fish growing out of the top of your head. You can be as like boring as you like if you're from Mars.
That's honestly very true. We would just be fascinated by the fact that you were from Mars.
There you go. That would be a good example of min-maxing.
Well, we certainly got here from talking. Well,
we certainly got somewhere.
The conversation goes where it goes, but I feel like we're wrapping up. So let's wrap up before we start blathering too much about weird stuff.
Sounds good. Thanks for listening to the show that comes after Slightly Civil War podcast, which was on the subject of review scores this week and why they're a waste of time and you're all bad people for expecting them.
It's very, very true. You can watch the original episode over on escapistmagazine.com, where you can become an Escapist Plus member and watch our videos ad-free and have special bonus content. You can become a YouTube member over on YouTube, where you can get videos a week early and get special emotes and nameplates whenever we live stream. Very exciting. And you can follow us on Twitter, where, you know, we'll tell you when these episodes come out, and I'll talk about sandwiches that I eat because I am a big sandwich enthusiast.
Fun. I think that's everything.
Oh, well, let's plugged. Hope so.
See you next time, everyone.
Wait, we have it. We'll slightly see you later.
Fuck you.
Bitch.